Praise the Lord. Amen. It's always good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. You know, we come back week to week. You know, we can think about all the blessings we've had in those 7 days. Sure. Think about the blessings you had this morning. Think about the goodness of the Lord. Because he's done so much for you. You know, and we want to never forget where you came from, where God brought you from, where he's taken you to. You know, I look back on a week, and as y'all know, I teach driving, and so many times just a second here or a second there can make a big difference in your life. And so you want to make every hour count, you know, because we're not promised tomorrow. We plan for it, but we're not. And in one instance, life could change. But you want to know who you belong to. You want to know that you've done everything God asked you to do, the best of your abilities down here. So when he calls you home, you can go, hallelujah, Lord, I was faithful to you. And I held up your name. You know, in this day and age, I like those people who aren't afraid to pray wherever they're at. I remember being in a Hy-Vee once, and there must be a big family come in on Sunday afternoon, and we stopped in for lunch, and they put these tables together. There's probably 20 of them. But right there in Hy-Vee store down in Keokuk, Iowa, they held hands. They didn't make a spectacle. They didn't bring it to attention. Hey, you know what? We're praying here over at the table. You know? No, they just bowed their head and thanked the Lord. Because they weren't ashamed. That's what Paul says. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And one thing that came to my heart was Psalm 18. And I love the way David, you know, if you look at David's life, he didn't have the easiest life, let me tell you. Saul was always chasing him, and there's a lot of things going on. He didn't do things right. But the Bible calls him a man after God's own heart. And I thought about that. Does he have God's heart, or is he a man after God's heart? I always thought that. You can look at it both ways. I think he desires God's heart. I think he desired to do the things God wanted him to do. That's what I believe he was desiring. And that's the way we should be. Every morning, ask God, what can I do for you today? How can I glorify you today? God, watch my mouth. You know, you ever notice in the Old Testament when it's talking about putting blood on the priest, you know, and they would put blood on their thumb, you know, and they put it on their toe. And I got to thinking about it, and they put it on the ear. And I got to thinking, why does that symbolize? Put on the ear. God, watch what you're hearing. Watch what's going in that ear, right? You know, thumb, what are you going to do with your hands? Watch what your hands do. And your toe, put that on the big toe, right? Watch where you're walking. Watch where you're going. Let that blood cover you. You know, and they used to anoint Aaron from the top of his head and anoint his whole body. So it's coming down here. It's coming down. That's what we should look at, that God should cover us every day. And I tell you, a person can keep themselves out of a lot of trouble if they listen to what God says. If God says, no, don't do it, we shouldn't do it. I don't know. You know, some people, they want to pray after the fact. Yeah. You know, once they get themselves in trouble, then God help me get me out of trouble. I say, well, why didn't you pray to me before you got in trouble? Because God can tell you, he can tell you, if you go seek him, the Bible said, seek ye first the kingdom of God. You know, all the other things we had is seek ye first. And that's what God wants. He said he wants to seek those who worship him in spirit and in truth. He's seeking those. He's seeking people that will come after his heart and ask him. Think about God. He knows everything about you. You know, it's to me, I can't imagine, but, you know, we all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But to imagine, you know, you're sticking your tongue out at God or raising a fist up at God. I see people do that. You know, I see people don't want nothing to do with God. Well, he's the creator, whether you acknowledge him or not. He still created you. You didn't give birth to yourself, right? You didn't get here by yourself. And to think it, when he says your time to go home, it's going to be your time to go home, let me tell you. If it wasn't for him, you couldn't breathe. Everybody didn't wake up this morning. You know, and we got to always look at how good God is. Psalm 18, it says, I love you. And it's Psalm of David. I love you fervently and devotedly, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer, my God, my king, firm strength, in whom I will trust and take refuge, my shield, the horn of my salvation, my high tower. I love this next verse because it's all about our will. See, that makes a difference. I will. I will. And when you say, I will serve the Lord, when you give that over to him, I will, and you make that declaration, that's powerful in your life. I will call upon the Lord. I choose to. I will call upon the Lord who is to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. Think about that. I will call upon the Lord. That's where we need to go. I want to share this, not as an embarrassment to anybody, but the other day we was in Walmart parking lot. And a good friend, very good friend of mine, that's in this building, we ended up, there were some needs there, and we prayed. And so we're going to pray out in Walmart parking lot, right? And because I felt, you know, sometimes people say, would you pray for me? Let's do it right now. What, you know, sometimes we put it off. Yeah, I'll pray. No, we're going to pray right now. That's what I felt the Lord leading to pray right now. So we had this, there's three of us there, and this lady who came behind us, her car was parked right where we was praying. And so she had a service dog with her. She said, excuse me, came behind. So we started praying. So we prayed that God would touch this individual and open my eyes, and guess who joined in? That lady right there. I didn't even know. She, next thing you know, she was standing there and she was praying with us too. I said, hallelujah. I mean, that's powerful. Isn't that something? That was absolutely, we didn't ask her. She didn't have to be involved. And I got a big voice. She knew what we was doing. But we prayed right there. And to have that believer, obviously, tell you what, somebody ain't believing it. What are them guys doing? A bunch of nuts in the parking lot. Yeah. I said, well, I don't, we can be crazy for Christ's sake, but that's all right. Because I'm not ashamed. I'm going to pray right here if my brother needs prayer. And she joined us, and I thought, hallelujah. Yeah. I'm just thinking, hallelujah. We got another believer. It wasn't ashamed. We was total strangers to her. We didn't know. She didn't know us, but she knew one thing. That spirit identifies that we was praying and we was reaching out to reach God. And so, hallelujah. You know, and what we want to do today, we want to take this time to praise God. That's what we want to do. We're going to open this service and praise God. That's what we come to do. You know, I don't feel like when we come to church, I don't want to waste time. I always say I don't waste time. I'm here for a reason. And the reason is I come to worship God. When I was little, it wasn't like, where do you go to church? You know, people would ask sometimes, say, where do you go to worship at? That was the big thing. Where do you worship? That I remember that term. Where do you worship at? You know, and I said, are you religious? I used to hear that. Are you religious? And I always tell them, no, I'm not religious. I'm a Christian. It's not about religion. I'm a Christian. I serve Christ. I'm not ashamed to acknowledge him. That's a big difference, you know, because it's true. We've all heard it. You know, it is about a relationship. And the thing about it I love most about God is he don't give up on you. He keeps bearing with us. And I know I say the same things over and over, but sometimes you need to hear them over and over. It works. Because, you know, people always ask, Tim, does God give up on you? You know, that the first time or give you a second chance? I said, nope. It's not a second chance. He doesn't. Just think, if he gave us two chances at this life and to have a relationship with him and he was done with us, we would never have a chance.
That's right.
It's not two. It's not like God gives you second. It's like third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, and it keeps going out. How many times does God give you opportunity to serve him? Even when you turn away, walk away. And the thing I loved about when the Bible says all the disciples forsook him and fled, you know, that had to be a hard thing because fled doesn't mean they just walked away. They took off running.
Yeah.
You know, they fled. But you know what? The thing that I love about Jesus is when they come back together, he never just pointed his finger at them guys. You know, he said, well, you guys are a bunch of cowards. You know, he never said that. You know, he still showed his love to them. And them guys became fireballs. You look at their life after that, and especially Peter, who denied him. Because Peter was the one that the rest of these guys, you know, might deny it, but not old Pete. Yes, Pete will stand with you. You can count on Pete, you know. Well, you know, before the cock crow, you're going to deny me three times. Oh, no, that won't happen. What happened? Hey, wait, you know, he's by the fire up there, and it's like, hey, you sound like, oh, no, not me. No, you got me wrong. You know, well, you sound like you was there. No, I wasn't. I don't even know him. And you know how hard that would be for somebody you acknowledge for 3.5 years and you walk with him and don't know him. I got to share this and I got to move on. My mom, she was in a nursing home. And I'm telling you, this was probably one of the hardest days in my entire life. I was in a nursing home. And I came down, and one of my nieces had called me and says, you better go check on Granny. They called her Granny because she don't sound like herself. So I went down there, and she had taken some medicine in there. But basically that medicine made her forget the people coming in there, okay? So I went in there, and she was in the exercise. They was exercising, and she looked at me, and I looked at her, and I'm thinking, something's wrong. I don't think she knows who I am. No, I'm her youngest son, so I've been around. And at that time, I'd been in my 40s. And so the nurse that was walking her said, well, I'm going to take you back to the room and give her lunch. And said, you guys want to eat lunch with her? And so she's sitting there, and she's looking right across to me. And I'm telling you, she's looking me straight in the face, and she had no clue who I was. Mm. Boy, that hurt me. I've got to be honest, that hurt me so bad. The nurse says, you know who that is? And she just shook her head. I thought, wow, man, Mom, you know, you gave birth to me. I'm your son, the youngest one. And she did not know. She just shook her head. And then she said, that's your son, Tim. And then she smiled, and then she got that. And I'm telling you, I had to leave the room. I went out in the hall. I ain't afraid to say shame. I start crying because I'm thinking, that was so hard for me to not even know that your mom not even know you. And every time I think about that with Peter, you know, I'm thinking that how hard that, you know, I didn't even know him, you know, and that just struck me. And I thank God she did kind of come out of that before she passed away. But I just think about that. But, you know, when Jesus and Peter got together, you ever notice that Jesus never brought that up? He never brought that up. And I look at that, and people need to do that. When you forgive a person and you decide, I'm not going to bring it up, don't bring it up. Don't throw it up. Boy, I'm glad God don't do that all the time.
Yeah.
Boy, when I ask him to forgive me, I'm glad, you know, don't come up. Well, Tim, remember you did this and this and this and this and this. It's all cast in a sea of forgetfulness.
Yes,
and that's for us. Also, don't do no fishing, you know, because sometimes the hardest part for us is that we can't forgive ourselves. Let me tell you, when God Almighty forgives you, that ought to be enough.
That's right.
That ought to be enough. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right. I'm going to open this up. Yes.
Right. She grew up in an age where if they said don't do this and you don't do that, you don't go here, she did it.
Right.
And so I it really bothered me, and I thought, Lord, where does that scripture fit that says, you know, we'd have a sound mind? So I went and I got into it, and I looked at that. What did it mean, a sound mind? Well, it didn't mean what I thought. It didn't mean you wouldn't forget things, but it did mean you wouldn't be afraid.
Hallelujah.
No fear.
Hallelujah.
And it reminded me of a song that came out about a similar situation. It's a fantastic song. His mom forgot everything but Jesus.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
And she could sing all the old songs.
Hallelujah.
From back when she was a little girl, and he said, that's all that was important. She didn't forget him. He didn't forget her.
Yeah.
The other things she forgot were totally unimportant.
Hallelujah.
And I thought, isn't that the truth? Most of the things that we worry about, like, oh, what day is this? So, you know, you get busy, especially when you're retired. I mean, one day is like, it's six Saturdays and a Sunday.
Yeah.
So you forget, what is this, Monday to Saturday or Tuesday? But anyhow, God is good, and his promises are true,
yes.
And they stand forever, but sometimes we have to look, we looked at them one way, and I like what you said today about King David, a man after God's own heart. I never thought about it, but that makes a lot of sense.
Hallelujah.
He was after God's heart.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Tim, that was fantastic.
Praise the Lord. the Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Praise God.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Yes. All right. So, yes, brother. Yes.
He's not done with our nation.
That's right.
He's going to release his spirit. He quotes Joel 2:8-9. In the latter days, God's going to pour out his spirit on all flesh.
That's right.
So it's really encouragement. There's many more, but I won't take the time up to go into that. So, anyhow.
Yeah.
Thank God for his grace and his mercy.
Amen.
Amen. That's true. So true. That's so true.
Starting with the youth and children. So who raises the standard against who? I know the Lord is going to flood his presence in that place right now. I understand, and I pray for the families of those that have been lost and out there. But I know God's getting ready to move hard again. He's just throwing everything he can at that area. And watching Johnny Cash, June Carter, Heritage thing last night, confirming that Bluegrass Country, as we know, didn't come from Nashville. Rock and roll came from Nashville. But the heart of God through bluegrass music, through the gospel music and stuff, came from that same region. It came from that same region. So God is birthing something new in that region again, and the enemy's throwing his hands up. So pray for those in West Virginia not to lose heart, but stay the course of what God's doing, and pray for those that are in that region right now.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Someone else. Okay. Well, let's stand up, please. Prayer. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you today for all your goodness, Lord. Hallelujah. Father God, we thank you, Lord, that these prayers, these requests, these praises have gone up to you. The needs that are represented in this body by ones that maybe not said anything, but you know the needs in their heart right now. And you can supply all their needs. Hallelujah. That you are able. Is there anything too hard for you? For with God, all things are possible. Not some things, not a few things, but all things are possible. And that's what we're going to believe you. It's always about in the beginning God. And Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you touched our life. Lord, we thank you that your Holy Spirit will have the right of way. Hallelujah. Because you said, whether it's two or three touching or agreeing, you be in the midst. And you are in the midst of this congregation tonight, that you would work in everybody's heart. So today we can come and praise you. We can have a desire to serve you. Father God, that you would birth something magnificent, that we would always glorify you in everything that we do. Because it's all about you, God. It's all about you. Let us seek you first. Let us seek you first. Let us get that mind that was in Christ Jesus. Let that mind be in us. That you're always about renewing us. You're always about delivering. Hallelujah. Because you are the great deliverer. You are the great healer. Hallelujah. You are the one, hallelujah, that can make a way when there is no way. And Father God, today, just touch us all. Let us all know how valuable you are. Hallelujah. That, Lord, you are the cornerstone, the chief cornerstone. Hallelujah. You are the one, Lord, that puts the arms around us and tell us that you love us with an everlasting love. You are the God that can heal. You are the God that can forgive our sins and wipe them away and never bring them up again. Hallelujah. The Lord, we can come to you. We can come to the very throne before you, and you will listen, Lord. We thank you for that. How we can call upon you. You are our fortress, our deliverer, in whom we will trust with everything inside. We choose, Lord. We want you more in our heart. Oh, hallelujah. It says in Deuteronomy, I will love the Lord. Love the Lord, the God, with all your heart, all your soul, all my, your mind, everything within you. And let us today leave differently than when we came. Let us surrender every area of our life to you. That, Lord, you will get glory out of our lives. That people can see that we have spent time with you. They can see that there is a difference. And that difference is because we choose to serve you. The Almighty God, the Wonderful Father, the Counselor, the Mighty God, there's no God above you. And Lord, we thank you today. We ask you to meet all those needs and remember the different needs that are in our hearts. And we want to thank you today. We want to praise you today. And we want to give you the glory in your wonderful holy name. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Okay. And just please turn off your cell phone. Appreciate that. Okay, Eastern Gate House of Prayers, July 13th, 7 p.m. to say anything?
Amen. No, just go press in on the Lord. There's a lot of stuff going on, and we just want to stay tuned into what He wants to reveal to our in our midst and for this region. Lord.
Hallelujah. Let's speak the word. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Hallelujah. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body function to perfection to which God created to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Hallelujah. Don and John, come up prayer. Come up for take the offering, please. Rest can be seated. Thank you. Hallelujah.
Revelations of what had happened at the Walmart parking lot is another evidence that you have thousands who haven't bent their knee to Baal.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Lord, we just trust you. We know that there are many who just have kept their silence out of fear, but you promised that you would take care of their fear. And when the time is right, all those people will step forward. And your word will go forth with a mighty, like a mighty arrow. We just ask that you bless this offering, bless this service. Be with us this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Brother Tim.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Glory, 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 glory. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Keep Cindy lifted up. She had another night, sleepless night. We're claiming the healing for her breathing and coughing situation, so hallelujah. 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 After last Sunday's exuberant worship, we didn't scare you all away. Some of you came back, or most of you came back. Something about visitors. I love visitors. Some come and taste and see, and I've seen many times where they came and tasted and scared the hell out of them, I guess you might want to say, for lack of words. But then they remember a few weeks down the road, or 6 weeks down the road, or 8 weeks down the road, and I miss that taste. So just pray for those that were here last week that we don't see this morning, but that's okay. We're just doing what the kingdom wants to do and releasing it. My wife, she watches a six-year-old girl named McKenna, and Cindy and I both have the same shirts, and McKenna calls this our paradise shirts because it looks like something from paradise. Well, pastor's got his on too. I believe the Lord wants to release heaven on earth in this place. a bit of paradise. So let's just step into it. The joy of the Lord is our strength. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Hallelujah, Lord. I believe there's going to be healing in this room this morning. Breaking off chains, breaking off depression, breaking off things that have been hindering us for years. Hallelujah, Lord. Breaking it off, 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 in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, Lord. Healing, healing for Peter, healing for Peter, healing for Peter, healing for Peter right now, in Jesus' name. Healing for Peter. He belongs up on this platform right now. Healing for Peter right now, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, Lord. For Pam, Lord. Lifting up Pam, Lord Jesus. Lifting her up, Lord Jesus. Those whom you are calling from the east and the west and the north and the south. Hallelujah,
since faith can move mountains, let the mountains move.
Yes.
We come with expectation.
Yes.
We're waiting here for you.
I see the Lord and His strength heals the temple. I see the Lord, He is high and lifted up. I see the Lord. Lord, He is high and lifted.
Rivers will flow.
streams and rivers will flow in this day. Abundant life, this is your song. The Lord birthed it in this room. The Lord birthed this song in this room because he knows there are people who will take this river of living water out into the highways and the byways. His word will not come back void. So all I'm asking you, take the kingdom that is within you and breathe it out on those in this world, those whom you come in contact with. Do not relent. Release the word and the love of the Lord. Release the good news that it is finished. Your breath is over me. Your breath. Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You hold it all in your hands, Lord. We thank you, Lord. The power is yours. The glory is yours. All is yours. Thank you, Jesus. And you've given us dominion and authority in this earth. And it's by your power that we reign on earth as you in heaven. Father, we thank you for your word that releases that power into this realm so that your kingdom can come, so that it can be on earth as it is in heaven. And all the glory and all the praise belongs to you and to you alone. And Lord, we just thank you today for your goodness and your faithfulness to us. Thank you that you are our Heavenly Father, a good God, a loving God, the only true God. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Give the Lord a hand. Praise God. Amen. God bless you. Be seated, please. Amen. Sunday school kids can be dismissed if they haven't already. And thank you, worship team. As always, great job. Praise the Lord. Thank God. Well, sometimes people believe, a lot of times even Christians, that God is the source of their problems, and that he brings trials and sickness and problems into people's lives to teach them something, or to make them stronger, or make them a better witness to somebody else, or what have you, because bad stuff happens in the world, amen? And they just assume then that either God did it or God allowed it. And that's not true, because God has given us dominion on this earth. And that was part of the redemption, that we received back what Adam had given away. And as always, the enemy is out to make God look bad, look mean, look vindictive, look unloving. And that's what he's done for millennia, and what he will continue to do until this thing is wrapped up, praise the Lord. So somebody has to be a little smarter than the devil, praise the Lord. And we can be. Because of this, left to our own intellect and abilities, Satan's got a lot of years of knowledge. Amen. He's learned some stuff, and he's made some mistakes. So he made one really big one that he'll be paying for forever. Amen. But none of us are going to live long enough to make all the mistakes we need to get as smart as we need to be. Praise the Lord. So we got to kind of take advantage of other people's mistakes and learn from the Word of God how good our God really is. That, I believe, really is the key. The love of God is the key that's going to release every promise that God has ever made. Amen. It's already done, and it was done by the love of God, for God so loved the world. But now it's a question of whether or not we appropriate that through our belief and through our actions and through our words, just like what was spoken of here today. God was seen in a parking lot at Walmart. Amen. And that's what we do. You know, I mean, we are the body of Christ. And so, you know, when those opportunities arise, wherever they arise, that's God wanting to be manifest. That's God wanting to be real to somebody. And real in a way where they can experience the love of God, where they can experience God's favor and God's compassion for them. Amen? So let's get right into this. I want to begin with Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 5. Genesis 3, verses 1 through 5. We all know this stuff, but this just, I want to get some things into context here as we move forward. But the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, has God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? So immediately he comes in and tries to create a question where there is no question. And the woman said to the serpent, we can eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, you're not going to die. For God knows that in the day that you eat thereof, your eyes will be opened and you'll be as gods, knowing good and evil. He's saying, if you do what I tell you to do, you'll know as much as God knows. You'll be God. They were already gods, little g. They were created after the image of God, by God himself. And Satan immediately comes to try to convince them that God is not good, that God's withholding, that God's denying them, he's suppressing them, he's oppressing them, and that Satan wants to set them free. He wants to give them whatever it is they really need so that they can be empowered to do what they want to do. Praise the Lord. All right, drop, if you can, Sheila, drop down to verses 14 and 15. And the Lord God said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and thus shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. Now, I don't know what the serpent was prior to this, but I know he's a snake now. Amen. From that moment on, he became a snake. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise its heel. All right? So now, let's just move on to Colossians, and so I don't get ahead of myself. Colossians chapter 1, verses 12 through 14. Colossians 1, 12 through 14. So we know what the enemy's deal is, and we know that God has power over him. So giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness, and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. And this is just a quickly saying what God has done for us, even though Adam sold out our birthright, more or less. This is telling us we have this inheritance back, that God has redeemed us back to that original purpose for man to rule and to reign as gods on earth. Amen? As representatives of God, okay? So now let's go to Romans chapter 8, and I'm going to read a fairly lengthy portion of Scripture here, and then we'll get right into this. Romans 8, 28 through 39. So Romans 8, 28 through 39. And again, this is just continuing to affirm and validate what God has done through Christ, where we are today, as opposed to where we would have been throughout history up until the time of Christ. Aliens separated from God in a kingdom that now is being ruled, or at that time was being ruled by Satan himself. And he's still here. Amen? He still functions the same way he's always functioned. We know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Now, I'm not a Calvinist, but at the same time, we were in Christ before the foundation of the world. So from a human perspective, it sounds like this is predestination. But it's not. It's simply because God knows the end from the beginning. He knew exactly who's going to respond to him. He doesn't stop reaching for everybody, even though he knows many of those that he's reaching for aren't going to respond. But he does it anyway so that there can be no sense of God's unfairness or God's lack of love or compassion or commitment to the lost. Amen? So that his dream is that everyone, if I could call it a dream, for everybody to be back in the garden, for everybody to be back in the relationship with this good God. That's what he's paid the price for. That's what he's sacrificed for. Amen? That's the heart of God. So Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called, and whom he called, them he also justified, and whom he justified, them he also glorified. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? And he that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It's God that justifieth, and he's just simply saying, all right, who is it that's going to charge God's children with sin or corruption or bad, whatever they want to call it, behavior? It's a rhetorical question, obviously, because he says, it's God that justified you. He's the all-powerful one. If he justified you, who is it that's going to be able to come back now and accuse you? Well, we know one will, but that's beside the point. The point is it's God that has justified us, so he's the only one that could, therefore, judge us. Praise the Lord. So who is he that condemneth? It's Christ that died, yea, rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I'm persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, that would include the devil and all of his helpers, praise the Lord, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature, shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Praise God. Hallelujah. Now that's the truth. Praise the Lord. And you'd almost have to really work at that to mix and mess it up to a place where you couldn't understand the simplicity of what God has done. He became sin. We become the righteousness of God in Christ. Amen. Put back in the position where we have dominion in this world. We are God's agents on this planet to rule and to reign. Amen. Now, how many here have never seen The Wizard of Oz? I thought so. Praise the Lord. So you've been watching TV or something, right? No, I'm just kidding. I've probably seen The Wizard of Oz. You know, I don't even want to guess because it's just be an outrageous number. I watched it when I was a kid multiple times. I've watched it multiple times with my kids. And I'm watching it with grandkids now. And it comes on, and I'll still, no, I can't watch the whole thing because I'm doing the dialogue for them. But I'll, you know, I kind of watch it a little bit, and then I'll watch something else come back, just because it's still kind of fascinating and weird. But in The Wizard of Oz, Dorothy and her buddies, you know, the Tin Man, the Cowardly Lion, and the Straw, the Scarecrow, they, as the thing begins to wrap up, they capture the Wicked Witch's broom, right? And they bring the broom back to Oz, and that's supposed to be their stamp so that they can go back to Kansas, or so that Dorothy can go back to Kansas. And the Tin Man's going to, you know, he's going to get a heart, and the Scarecrow is, you know, he's going to get a brain, and the Lion's going to get courage, and Dorothy's going home, right? That's what the deal was. Well, they get there, and they're scared to death of this wizard, because, you know, he's the all-powerful Oz, and he's got smoke blowing and you know, lightning flashing, and there's this, the great Oz, you know, this loud, you know, kind of frightening voice, and they're freaking out, and then Toto pulls back the curtain, and they see this little guy in there pulling levers and pushing buttons and just going like crazy, and he's just this little nondescript nobody, just kind of, and they're going like a madman trying to create this continuous stuff. And once he's caught, the guy looks over and he sees him, and then he tries to pull the curtain back, you know, and he says into this microphone, he goes, pay no attention to the man behind the curtain. And I mean, come on, you're busted, man, but he just, you know, he can't give it up, right? And these four, with Dorothy, who were so freaked out and so scared, they realize that this wizard, he's just a con man. He's just a guy that's manipulating, you know. Satan is like the Wizard of Oz. Amen. He's been defeated at the cross. Look at Colossians chapter 2, verses 13 through 15. I'm going to try to, I mean, I know what we believe, you know, but we need affirmation, we need confirmation, we need reassurance, we need to be reminded, because we're the ones, we're the agents that are going to bring this to somebody else. And so unless we really got it, unless we're really convinced, it's difficult to convince anybody else. Amen. So having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. Let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of a holy day, or of the new moon, or of the Sabbath days. Praise the Lord. Having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly. Now, in other words, we got a little ahead of ourselves there, but that's fine. Jesus destroyed the power of the enemy. How did he do that? He did it by keeping the law perfectly so that the law could be fulfilled. Amen. And then he went to the cross and died a sinner's death for us so that God could then give us the benefits of keeping the law, although we never were able to keep it. We get the benefit of it because Jesus took the punishment for our not keeping it. And then he transfers that righteousness to us, removing the weapon of the enemy. What the devil always used was the law. You got to do it. And you can't do it. So you need a sacrifice. And unless that sacrifice is good enough, you got a problem. And even then, if the sacrifice was good enough, you're going to have a problem again because you're going to sin again and you're going to have another sacrifice. So it's that's the tool, condemnation, guilt, shame, failure, that the devil has always used. He just like with Adam and Eve, he tempts you, he cons you into the act by telling you how great it is and what power you're going to have as a result of it. And then the moment you do it, he's like the kid at school that used to say, come on, let's sneak out of class. And the next day he's back there telling the teacher, you know, Nathan talked me into doing this. I wasn't going to go, but he... You know, the rat that gets you to do the stuff and then rats you out for doing it. And that's the devil. He tempts you. He gives you this. This will be great. You know, you're gonna know stuff that you can't imagine. You'll be powerful. And then the moment that you do it, what a flake. What a jerk. You know, you've failed now. You're nothing. You're naked, man. You're naked. You got nothing. Somebody told him they were naked. Right? So this is what he does. That's just the way he operates. All right, 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 14. Their minds were blinded, for until this day remaineth the same veil untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ, which is what I basically just said in a different way. Okay? They're blinded to the promises of God through the sacrifice of God. They're blinded to what God, to God's love and to God's mercy and to God's grace by the reading of the law. Because reading the law, they see bad stuff is going to happen to us because we're not good enough. And they cannot see the goodness of God, the grace of God, and the love of God. That's what Satan uses to blind, amen, people. Praise the Lord. So, we've already read he was stripped of his power, and now he hides behind this curtain of deception, which is this veil. Until that veil is taken away. The only way that veil can be taken away, the only way the curtain can be pulled back, is by a revelation of God's goodness, by seeing the goodness of God. And so here the devil is pulling levers, pushing buttons of suffering, strife, making impossible demands on people that he knows and they know they can't keep, trying to make us think he's a match for God, that he's an equal to God. and even that God collaborates with him to test us. I mean, that's some convoluted thinking, but I'm telling you, there's a lot of the church that believes this stuff. Amen? And so a lot of times we've picked up stuff over the years, and maybe we don't dwell on it, maybe it isn't something we meditate on, but it still comes out in our behavior and in our, you know, interactions with other people. Because we don't have a clear way of saying, no, that's not true, that's not God. God would never do that. Well, then who's doing it? It's an act of God. Amen? Pay no attention to the guy behind the curtain. Hallelujah. He's a liar and the father of them. All right, let's go. Isaiah chapter 14 and verse 12. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? If you can, drop down to verse 16 and 17. They that see thee shall narrowly look upon thee and consider thee, saying, is this the man that made the earth to tremble, that did shake kingdoms, that made the world as a wilderness and destroyed the cities thereof, that opened not the house of the prisoners? It's talking about this Lucifer, Satan, the devil. Amen? Not only are people going to be shocked that they were ever afraid of him, they're going to be stunned to think how easily he tricked people into believing lies about God and how good God is, how loving God is. So this morning, I want to take something that all of us relate to in some way or another, and I hear it all the time from people that are going through all sorts of stuff. Oh, I've had the life of Job. I've been going through one thing after another, after another, after another. But I want to actually use the book of Job this morning to expose Satan and his deceptions. Now, first of all, we have to realize that historically, the book of Job is probably the oldest story or revelation that God has in the Scripture. It's believed that the events that take place in Job happened long before the birth of Abraham. So it's like the oldest recorded thing that takes place in the Bible outside of the Adam and Eve story. So the story of Job then, chronologically, it takes place somewhere between Genesis chapter 4 and Genesis chapter 7. Now that's important to understand because understanding where the book of Job took place historically, it really begins to explain the condition that you find Satan in at the time. Praise the Lord. We read that Satan or Lucifer is a created being. In other words, because he's a created being, he has to gain knowledge and he has to gain understanding about humanity and the world that we live in, and even God and the way God operates. And he has to do that through learning. He just didn't show up with all knowledge. He's not God. He was created, so he has to learn this stuff. Amen? So look at this in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 7 and 8. 1 Corinthians 2, verse 7 and 8. We speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. All right, so to us, looking back, it's clear what God was doing through Christ, right? The death, burial, and resurrection. But at the time, Satan didn't have any idea what God was doing. Amen? He had no idea that killing Jesus would result in his own destruction and also freedom for all of us, amen, from Satan's dominion, from his authority. If he'd known that, he would have never done that. That's his agenda, is to have dominion over us, to control us, to manipulate us, amen? If he'd have known it, he'd have done anything. He'd have done everything to prevent it. But it also means the knowledge and the understanding that Satan had in the garden after the fall was limited compared to what he knows now thousands of years later. Praise the Lord. Lucifer, the one that you see in the garden tempting Adam and Eve, isn't the same Lucifer that you see through the rest of the Bible. Now, I don't mean that it's a different one. I mean that he's learning. He's figuring out, how can I manipulate people? How can I control them? How can I turn them against God? How can I show them that this God is horrible and that they should follow me, or that they should just follow their own instincts or what have you? Amen? Because unlike God, Satan changes. He learns by observation. He learns by trial and error. Praise the Lord. He's not omniscient. He's got to learn stuff. So what happens in Job? It took place just a few generations after Adam. Praise the Lord. So there's this usurping of power that Satan manipulated and did in the garden, and he gets the power that Adam and Eve had and their authority as a result of the fall. They just signed over their inheritance. Praise the Lord. Because remember, Adam and Eve, they were like co-owners of the earth, of the lease that God gave them for the thousands of years that man would be on the earth, right? So God entered into an agreement with them. Here, you've got dominion. I'm releasing my authority to you. You have like power of attorney here on earth, and it's your authority that everything has to respond to, right? Well, they sold that out and gave it to Satan. And then they became guilty of the very same crime that Satan was guilty of, which is rebellion, which put all of us in that same category coming into the world as we're born, right? All right, 1 John chapter 5, verses 17 through 20. 1 John 5, 17 through 20. All unrighteousness is sin. That's what we talk about all the time. We're righteous because of his righteousness. Amen? He has declared us righteous in Christ. So everybody outside of Christ is a sinner. This is not about self-righteousness. This is about the righteousness that has been given to us. Amen? So all unrighteousness is sin. There's a sin not unto death. We know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not. Now, that sounds like a contradiction, because we know we get born again, we still sin. I mean, we still do stuff that's not good, right? But it's not considered sin because there is now no law for us who are the redeemed, right? So whoever is born of God, they don't sin, because by definition, they can't. They can still do stuff that's not right, but it's not sinning, amen, because they are already covered by the blood, amen? So all righteousness is sin, there is a sin not unto death. We know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not, but he that is begotten of God keepeth himself, and that wicked one toucheth him not. Everybody says, you can't touch me. Amen? You cannot touch me, devil. Amen? If you realize who you are, he can't touch you. Praise God. Now, Satan, we know the Son of God has come and hath given us understanding that we may know him that is true, and we are in him that is true, even his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. So if you got a question about the God of the Old Testament being angry and mean and vicious and whatever, he's telling us he is the exact representation of God. He is the God of creation now manifest in flesh. Amen. This is the true God. This is the true identity. This is the true reflection. This is the true representation. This is the reality of God. This is who he is. And that's true God and eternal life, or God life. is what that word is. Amen? So, Satan exercised his authority until Christ disarmed him at the cross. Praise the Lord. So anybody now who's in Christ is back to the original position that Adam was in before the fall. Authority, dominion, relationship with God. Anybody outside of that is still under the same conditions that Adam and Eve were in immediately following the fall. Cut off from God, dependent on their own effort, by the sweat of their brow, so on and so forth. Okay? So we know where we're at. We are redeemed. We are in the age of grace, the dispensation of grace. God is on our side. God is for us. God is all about blessing us and healing us and delivering us. Amen? All right, back to Colossians 2:15 then. Having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them. The enemy's defeated. And Jesus does a little salsa dance on his forehead afterwards to just show everybody that this guy is done. He's been defeated, right? But like Oz, Satan wants us to believe his power is still intact and that God is the source of our problems, like Adam and Eve believed. We'd have everything if it wasn't for God. We'd be better off if it wasn't for God. Right? So he's defeated, but he wants to continue to convince us that God's the problem. He's the one that's keeping you from everything that you could do or would like to do or be a part of or accomplish. Amen? So we, as the believers, our calling is to expose the devil and show the world that God is really good, that he is a loving God, that he is a good God. Amen? As long as there's a chance that God is the source of our problems, we're not going to have miracles. We're not going to have breakthroughs. We're not going to have restoration on any meaningful level. Amen? Praise the Lord. Unless we can totally trust in God and his intentions, we're always going to be second-guessing every situation that we're confronted with. Amen? Negative stuff is going to happen. We're in the world, and there's tribulation. And if you don't have total confidence of what God's intentions are towards you and how he feels about you, then you're always going to be in conflict every time something negative or some circumstance that doesn't fit our idea of being blessed. Praise the Lord. It makes it difficult. Hallelujah. And it ends up limiting the supernatural flow of God in our lives. Praise God. All right, let's go to the book of Job. And I want to read from chapter 1, verses 7 through 12. And then I want to show you how religion has twisted this stuff around to cause us to question whose side God is on. Amen? So the Lord said unto Satan, "Whence comest thou?" Then Satan answered the Lord and said, "From going to and fro in the earth and from walking up and down in it." And the Lord said unto Satan, "Hast thou considered my servant Job? There's none like him in the earth, a perfect and an upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil." Then Satan answered the Lord and said, "Doth Job fear God for nothing? Hast thou not made a hedge about him and about his house and about all that he has and every side? Thou hast blessed the work of his hands and his substance is increased in the land. But put forth your hand now and touch all that he has, and he'll curse you to your face." And the Lord said unto Satan, "Behold, all that he hath is in thy power. Only upon himself put not forth thine hand." So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. Amen. So, verse 7, if you can, go back to verse 7 and 8, Sheila. And the Lord said unto Satan, "Whence comest thou?" Then Satan answered the Lord and said, "From going to and fro in the earth and from walking up and down in it." And the Lord said unto Satan, "Hast thou considered my servant Job? There's none like him in the earth, a perfect and an upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil." Now that's kind of a perplexing question if you think about it. He says, "I'm going around like a roaring lion, seeking whom I may devour." And God says, "Have you thought about Job?" I mean, that's the way we've read it. That's the way it's been basically taught, amen, that Satan responds, actually, here, look at verse 11. Put forth your hand now and touch all that he has, and he'll curse you. All right? And then God concludes this in verse 12 by saying, the Lord said to Satan, behold, all that he has is in your power. Only upon himself put not forth thine hand. So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. So based on the common interpretation of Job, most Christians believe something like this. There's this big bully out in the street roaming up and down, messing with all the kids on the block, beating them up, stealing their stuff. And you say to him, how about my kid? And that's not true. Who of us would do that? Well, we might go out and thump the bully, send him home or do something. But we're not going to say, hey, you haven't beat up my kid yet. He's a good kid. How about beating him up and stealing his bike? Praise the Lord. All right, look at this in Lamentations chapter 3, verse 33. For he doth not afflict willingly, nor grieve the children of men. That's God. Who are you going to believe? Right? Look at 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 7. God cares for us. Amen. Casting all your care upon him because he cares for you. Now, if we take the reading of Job in the way that we normally hear it, these are contradictions to what we just read, believing it in the traditional way. 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 18. The Lord shall deliver me from every evil work and will preserve me unto his heavenly kingdom, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. That's good news. The Lord will deliver you from every evil work. Amen. And preserve you unto his heavenly kingdom. Now somehow in the book of Job, in the context of what we've read, in spite of everything that we know about God's love made manifest in the person of Jesus Christ, it still results in an invention of a God who only exists in religious traditions. Praise the Lord. I'd find it very difficult to have a really meaningful relationship with the God of Job, in the sense of having any security that he might not sell me out the next time I'm really good. Praise the Lord. This isn't blasphemy. I'm just saying what we've been taught and what many of us have believed. And so we avoid that book because it doesn't fit, you know, in our idea of what we're supposed to be believing about the goodness of God. So here he says, have you considered my servant Job? Job 1 and 8. Now I want to show you some things that I've discovered over the last week. If you look in the, I know in the Strong's Concordance, and then there's also the history of the Old Testament that will sometimes take you beyond what the Concordance can give you because it doesn't do a definitive research on all the words. But if it isn't there, it will point you to this other book where there is a deeper search for the basis of these words in Hebrew and Greek because they're so unlike English. They have multiple meanings depending on the context and so forth, the structure of the sentence and all that. But here's my point. In Strong's Concordance, the word consider is 7760, so you can look it up for yourself. And it's the word, phonetically, it's pronounced soon, and the Hebrew word. And it means to set or to put, okay? And then the rest of that meaning is 3820 from Strong's Concordance, which means, the Hebrew word is leb, which means heart. So if you read it in a direct translation from Hebrew to English, it would read, "Have you set your heart on my servant Job?" He isn't saying, "Have you thought about busting him up?" No, he's asking him a question. Are you going around roaming around here? Have you set your heart on my servant Job? Are you getting ready to put in on him? You know? Praise the Lord. So God isn't agreeing to Satan's suggestion. It's not like he's offering Job up as a challenge to, like, see what you can do with this guy. It's not what's happening at all. God was actually accusing Satan of considering harm to Job. Amen? So God's response to Satan roaming around, seeking whom he may devour, was actually, "What have you been doing, Job? Or what have you been doing, Satan? Have you set your evil intentions on Job? Are you considering harming him? There's nobody on earth like this guy. Don't lay a finger on him," is the next thing he says. And the passage actually then read in the true context of how it was written, it actually glorifies God's goodness and it reveals God's intentions and the real nature of the question is, what are you up to with this? This guy is righteous. He's a good guy. What are you up to? You got your focus on him to mess his life up? Is that what you're about here? You see what I'm saying? Hallelujah. So, if you look at verses 11 and 12, "Put forth thine hand now and touch all that he has, and he'll curse thee to the face. And the Lord said unto Satan, Behold, all that he hath is in your power. Only upon himself put not forth thine hand." So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. Now, it looks like Satan is a formidable foe, like he is, you know, a peer of God's or something. Like he can get into this battle with him, right? And it looks like that Satan was able to convince God to not only remove his protection from Job, but allow Satan to be God's agent then of destruction. Are you with me? Praise the Lord. So generally, Job is thought like this. We think of it. Satan tempts God to withhold his hand of protection from Job. God gives in, and then God teams up with Satan to inflict hardship on Job. Praise the Lord. Am I the only one that's ever thought this? Or, you know, okay, praise the Lord. All right, James 1:13, you don't have to go there, Mike, I'll just read it off, just save your fingers here. But James 1:13 says, God cannot be tempted. He cannot be tempted by evil. Nor does he tempt anyone. So there's another lie exposed. Either our interpretation of Job is flawed, or else the rest of the Bible is contradicting it. Praise the Lord. All right. Then in Job chapter 1, verse 12. The Lord said unto Satan, Behold, all that he hath is in thy power, only upon himself put not forth thine hand. So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. All right, now look at this. Behold. In the King James, it's the Hebrew word hineh, H-I-N-N-E-H. And that word means very well. Praise the Lord. So what God says is, very well, all that he has is in your power. What was God saying? I'm giving you this power? No, he's saying, you have power and authority here on the earth now because you took it from Adam. Very well. You can manipulate the guy because you've got a legal right to do it. God cannot interfere without defiling himself and making himself unholy, unfair, dishonest. Praise the Lord. So he's saying, basically, you usurp man's authority a while back here, a couple of generations back, and for now, you have a legal right to act on this earth. That's what he's saying very well. And although Satan seized the authority after the fall and he attacked Job and all that he had, Job really didn't have a real conceptual understanding of Satan. Satan hadn't been around that long, so they didn't have a real clear grasp of what this enemy was all about, nor did they have a totally completed revelation of God. So they were limited in their understanding in both areas. Amen? So look at Job chapter 9, verses 13, and we're going to read verses 13 through 24. If you haven't read Job, you need to go back and read it sometime from this perspective. But I'm doing this just to show you some of the stuff that goes on there so you can have a better understanding of what's actually taking place here. Beginning at verse 13 through 24. We may not read all of it. I just want to get enough in here. So if God will not withdraw his anger, the proud helpers do stoop under him. How much less shall I answer him and choose out my words to reason with him? Whom though I were righteous, yet would I not answer, but I would make supplication to my judge. If I had called and he had answered me, yet would I not believe that he had hearkened unto my voice. For he breaketh me with a tempest and multiplieth my wounds without cause. He's talking about God here, not the devil. He will not suffer me to take my breath, but filleth me with bitterness. Now, that's enough for that. We're just enough to get you to understand. The idea that his problems came from the enemy don't even occur to Job. He's convinced it's God. He never even mentions the devil. It's like he's oblivious to the fact that this could be a demonic attack. All right? To think that God allows things in our lives to teach us or to correct us or to do some other positive thing is to be ignorant of another entity at work, Satan. Amen? So the later parts of the book of Job, his friends are having already mistakenly decided that God's responsible for all of Job's problems is how this thing goes on. So look at Job 18, verses 1 and 2. And again, this is just to give you a little capsule of what's going on in these people's minds here. For he breaketh me with a tempest and multiplieth my wounds. Okay, then answered Bildad the Shuhite and said, how long will it be ere ye make an end of words? Mark, and afterwards we will speak. In other words, he's saying, how long are you going to keep talking about this? Shut up and we'll tell you what the problem is. You know, Job is going on about, I'm righteous, this can't be God. I mean, why would God punish me? And if it's God, I don't understand why he's doing this, and so on and so forth. And they're saying, well, if you shut up, we'll tell you. We'll explain it to you. You're evil. You're a sinner. And it's God punishing you, all right? Chapter 19, verse 1 through 7. Then Job answered and said, how long will ye vex my soul and break me in pieces with words? These 10 times have you reproached me. You are not ashamed that you make yourselves strange to me. And be it indeed that I have erred, mine error remaineth with myself. If indeed you will magnify yourselves against me and plead against me in my reproach, know now that God hath overthrown me and hath compassed me with his net. Behold, I cry out of wrong, but I'm not heard. I cry aloud, but there's no judgment. In other words, he's saying, I'm crying out to God to say, I'm being wronged here. But he won't even respond. Praise the Lord. Chapter 20, verse 1 through 5. Then answered Zophar the Naamathite and said, therefore do my thoughts cause me to answer, and for this I make haste. Another one of his friends. I have heard the check of my reproach, and the spirit of my understanding causes me to answer. Knowest thou not this of old, since man was placed upon the earth? That the triumphing of the wicked is short and the joy of the hypocrite but for a moment. So he's saying, you know, I've been around for a while and I've learned something. People like you, Job, you look like you got it all together. Got all your, you know, big family. You got this huge farm. You got your cattle. You got your stock. And it looked like everything was going great. But you're wicked. And your end has finally come. I've seen it over and over and over. That's what he's telling me. There's sin. You're a sinner or this would not be happening to you. All right? So chapter after chapter of Job's self-righteousness. I don't deserve this. I'm a good guy. I've done everything right. I'm, you know, godly. I'm whatever. I'm a righteous man. and chapter after chapter of his friends saying, no, you're a wretch, you're a sinner, you're a despicable, and you're getting what you deserve. Amen? Then God shows up. He shows up to settle the score, amen, and to give Job this supernatural hearing that he asked for. But he had no idea what he was getting in for. But he did ask for it. Job 13, verse 3. He's asking for a hearing in God's court of law, basically. The triumph. Surely I would speak to the Almighty, and I desire to reason with God. Boy, that's presumptuous, to say the least. I'm going to reason with God. He's confused, apparently. God is mixed up here, and somebody needs to straighten him out. Hallelujah. So, is Job right, or are his friends right? Is he righteous? Is he a sinner? Neither one of them are right. Job 38:2. Who is this that darkeneth counsel by words without knowledge? This is the Lord speaking now. Amen? Who is this that darkeneth counsel by words without knowledge? So, counsel is the information you need to get your act together, right? You go to counseling, right? Well, he said, you're darkening the counsel. In other words, you're making it impossible to be counseled. You know? You can't argue with a fool. You end up with two fools arguing because nothing works out. I mean, they're not getting it. And that's basically what God is saying here. Without knowledge. All right? Chapter 40, verse 1. Moreover, the Lord answered Job and said, Babu. Shall he that contendeth with the Almighty instruct him? He that reproveth God, let him answer it. You know so much, you tell me what the problem is. Verse 8. Wilt thou also disannul my judgment? Wilt thou condemn me that thou mayest be righteous? You're going to blame me so that you can be considered righteous? That I'm doing this stuff? That I'm unrighteous? To prove your righteousness. All right, chapter 42, verse 7. And it was so that after the Lord had spoken these words unto Job, the Lord said to Eliphaz the Temanite, my wrath is kindled against thee and against thy two friends, for you have not spoken of me the thing that is right, as my servant Job hath. So what we're dealing with, and with other people that we come into contact with, is how do you make sense out of what we know about God's mercy and God's grace with the negative circumstances that people believe He allows in their life? The idea that God was testing Job's faithfulness wasn't something that was ever concluded by Job or his friends. They believed He'd already been judged and found guilty. They didn't think that he was being tested. They were just saying he's a sinner, he's evil, and God's just punishing him for it. They believed God had already issued a righteous judgment against Job, and it was just his results of that judgment. And what Job believed was that God was more likely to crush him with a storm or overwhelm him with misery than he was to restore his life for some divine purpose. Praise the Lord. How many people that we come into contact with on an everyday basis, and I'm just talking about unbelievers now, but it's true even with believers, who are convinced that what God really wants to do to them is hurt them. He wants to crush them. He wants to destroy whatever good they have. But they cannot believe that He has some divine purpose for their life, where they can be blessed, where they can be made whole. The contradiction goes on today from the oldest story in the Bible. Praise the Lord. Job 42, verses 1 through 5. Then Job answered the Lord and said, I know that thou canst do everything, and that no thought can be withholden from thee. Who is he that hideth counsel without knowledge? Therefore have I uttered that I understood not things too wonderful for me, which I knew not. Hear, I beseech thee, and I will speak. I will demand of thee, and declare thou unto me. I have heard of thee by the hearing of the ear, but now my eye seeth thee. So in other words, what he had heard was a distortion. But now he'd seen the goodness of God and the mercy of God, and he asked forgiveness. God had even spoke to him already, saying, you know, you've misrepresented me. Me, you and your friends have totally misrepresented me, and that's what ticks me off. That's what made God angry through this whole thing, that he was being presented as some evil tyrant that was just out to hurt people instead of this loving God. Job comes to his senses when he sees the goodness of God, the love of God, and he responds. Amen? And it's true that Job, he finally put his faith back in God, but it wasn't until a rebuke from God regarding everything that Job had misspoken about God. Praise the Lord. Amen. Let me just throw this out there for your consideration. I think you're more likely to anger God by doubting his faithfulness to you than you are to be a total spoiled brat and just take all of the goodness of God that you can get and just keep taking it and keep taking it and keep taking it and keep taking it and keep taking it, because that's the reality of who God is. When we say, well, God's going to withhold it because I didn't do this or I did that or I've got a bad day or I've had an issue with somebody or whatever, then all of a sudden now God's punishment's going to fall or there's going to be bad stuff happening. Man, wake up and smell the roses. Hallelujah. Get a clue. Repentance is what Job did. He didn't fall on his face and weep and cry. He'd been doing plenty of that. When he repented, what did he repent? He turned back and saw that God was good. That's what repentance is. I'm seeing God in the way that I should see him, and that changes my whole idea, changes my life, changes everything that I'm about, and it will change everybody around me. Praise the Lord. Amen? So, because of God's goodness, even though Job misspoke about him, because of God's goodness, God blessed him and turned everything around that the enemy had stolen and killed and destroyed. God turned it around for Job's good. Yes. It wasn't God getting a second thought about this and thinking, well, that's enough. This is about all this guy can take. Now I'm going to give him something back. God wasn't the author of the theft. He wasn't the author of the murder of his children and all these other things. That was all Satan. All God said was, they're under your authority in this world. The opportunity Job had to escape that was to turn to God and his goodness and his grace to be delivered. And once he did that, God turned it all back around. But God was helpless without Job being in agreement with God. Now the good news is we've been redeemed to this relationship again where we are in agreement with God. We are no longer outside of that because of the redemption of Jesus Christ. We've been restored. We should expect nothing but good from God. Will there be problems? Of course there will, because the devil's still here, roaming about, seeking whom he may devour. And if he can catch you, amen, in a place where you don't totally trust God, where you don't have complete confidence in God's feelings towards you and his purposes towards you, the enemy can come in and rip you off, even though it's your stuff, even though you have a right to it and the authority over it. Praise God. Amen. So the only purpose behind Job's suffering was the enemy wanting to steal, to kill, and to destroy. That's it. There wasn't some ulterior motive on God's part to teach everybody a lesson. Praise God. God did not sanction Job's testing. That's not what God does. Look at Colossians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10. We need to have a steady stream of the knowledge of the goodness of God, unbroken. And the enemy tries to sneak in and break that, like he does through the book of Job, like he did in the garden with Adam and Eve, like he does with every one of us. Amen. Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men. That's what's been developed out of the book of Job over the years. Because it doesn't fit anything, any other description or revelation of God. It does not fit. So it's a vain philosophy. It's a deceit. After the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. In him you get the reality of God, the truth of God. And you are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power. Satan does not come anywhere in a, you know, millennial idea of closeness with God. In terms of power, in terms of authority, in terms of knowledge. He's no different than a human that's lived a long time. Praise the Lord. Live long enough, you'll get kind of smart. Praise the Lord. Amen. Because you just learn stuff. Don't let the enemy cause you to question the goodness of God. Praise the Lord. God is with us. God is for us. Now and forever. We need to just yank back the curtain and expose that little demon for who he is and for what he is. Don't believe any more lies. Don't go for the smoke and mirrors. Believe the truth, and it'll set you free. Can you say praise the Lord? Amen. Give God a hand. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. God bless all of you. Go out. Be happy. Be free. God's on your side. Amen. The enemy's defeated. Keep him there. Hallelujah. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.